Now, how we watch over our children and whether the balance has tipped. It's the last installment in our series on Parenting Now. Throughout the week, we have looked at a wide variety of issues that mothers and fathers contend with, including their changing roles, the way we raise kids, and the cost of childcare. Judy taped this conversation earlier in the week about how we deal with risks and safety concerns when it comes to our children.
A generation ago, children walked to school by themselves and enjoyed hours of unsupervised play. Well, times have changed considerably, and so have attitudes about the way we raise our children. Journalist and author Hanna Rosin explored these issues in a recent cover story for The Atlantic, The Overprotected Kid. It has sparked a wide conversation about how we keep our children safe, perhaps too safe. And Hanna joins me now. Welcome to the program.
Thank you. I'm glad to be here.
So, overprotected kid, I think I know what you mean by that, but what did you mean?
What I mean is that we've become so preoccupied with safety that we're basically robbing our children of the chance to take risks, the kind of physical risks, emotional risks, the kind of risks they need to become independent adults, basically. And so I tried to explore why. Why did that happen? How did we change in one generation so drastically the norms of childhood?
So you start out visiting this really extraordinary, it's a playground, but it's kind of a non-playground in England, which is it's dirt and mud, it's all tires, it's on a creek, that kids can build fires. Why did you go to this place?
I heard about it and I was so excited because it's so different than the kinds of playgrounds we have today in the U.S. It's basically a junkyard. I mean, it really looks like a junkyard. Kids build fire. That's the most shocking thing. They play with tools, they play with sharp things, and they're supervised by these people called play workers who are hired by the government. But basically the idea is to let them learn on their own how to manage things that feel dangerous to them. Not that are dangerous, but that feel dangerous so that they can feel mastery over them.
But this was all part of a point of saying that we had gotten too far. We had gone too far in trying to keep kids safe, and this was an effort to pull back.
Yeah, the playground I meant for people is to read as a shock to the system to think, oh my gosh, there are places like this and children are allowed to do such things, you know. So I started the story that way just so people could see there is an alternative way that feels so far that the children adore. I mean, they can't wait for this place. I took my own son and he still talks about it every day. When can we go back there? Because there really is no place like that.
But this was a reaction to what? I mean, what has happened?
This was a reaction to how fearful we are of letting children take physical risks, so take playgrounds. Over the last 30 years, I describe how playgrounds have shifted towards the norm of safety almost to an extreme. The rubber padding, everything's been lowered a lot, everything's been homogenized. So there's no sense from the children that they're doing things which are a little bit scary and which they can master. They can pretty much already do everything even before they've gotten there. So the same thing for emotional risks. We like to protect our children, kind of basically intervene before anything bad happens. I think is what's considered a good parent these days.
And as you write, of course, it wasn't always like this. My generation, I mean, we went out in the afternoon after school and we didn't come back for hours. I mean, what happened along the way? Why did it turn out the way it has been lately?
Well, that was the impetus for me writing the story, is just thinking, how is it that my daughter's life is so different from mine? And I have three children, but all of them. How is it that I used to do things like most parents my age, play in the streets, play cops and robbers? My mom didn't really know where I was. I just had to be home for dinner. And that would be shocking and unthinkable now for children of this generation. I think it's because we have this sense that the world has become a dangerous place. That's what people say when you ask them, are you crazy? Why would I let my kid be out on the street on his or her own? They might get abducted. So we have this feeling that the world is a more dangerous place.
But is it really more dangerous? I mean, you looked at some statistics on what's happened to kids.
Yeah, I mean, in 2014, the world is definitely not a more dangerous place because our crime rates are so incredibly low. But the thing we are most afraid of, which is child abduction, those terrible, horrible stories we read about in the news, is just as rare now as it was in the 1970s. Telling your kids not to talk to strangers is in some ways a funny thing to do, even though it's become the norm, because it's not a common crime. If abductions have increased, it's because of divorce. So neighborhoods have changed. The world has become a different place, but not a more dangerous place.
What you go on to write about that this overprotectiveness has had consequences for kids. I mean, that they're growing up to be people who can't cope in some ways.
That's
some of them.
That's what I want people to think about after reading this story. We all go along with the tide. We do what other parents do. We think of it as, oh, we're being a good parent. But in fact, there are consequences to protecting your children in this way. There's a lot of psychologists and sociologists doing research that show the benefits of taking risk and mastering risk. It basically used to be thought of as going through the stages of childhood. I'm going to do this thing I'm afraid of, and then I'm going to master this thing, and that's where confidence comes from. And also the ability to take risks, think outside the box. There are measures, for example, of creativity, which have gone down in this generation. And creativity, by what they mean by that, is being able to think in ways that are different, that are not necessarily accepted, that are not approved necessarily by the people around you, to be an independent thinker, essentially.
And what do you say to, I mean, I can just hear some parents out there listening to this and saying, but I really do have to be careful. I can't imagine, you know, letting my child go off on his or her own for a long time, unsupervised.
Yeah, and that's common sense. You should keep your kids safe, but you shouldn't optimize every single decision you make shouldn't be in order to optimize safety. That's what I'm saying. I also don't think we should go back to the 70s. I think a lot of people might say, I was unhappy, my parents never paid any attention to me, and I really sympathize with that. That's not what I'm advocating for, because people felt neglected in the 70s, and I think it's really nice that people have close relationships with their children now. So that's not what I would want parents to take from this.
So is there advice that parents should think about? I mean, that's a heavy burden to put on you, but I mean, what should parents think?
In my mind, I think of it as slightly shifting the definition of what it means to be a good parent. So instead of saying what a good parent does is keep your child safe, add to that job description, what a good parent does is create opportunities for your child to think independently or take risks, or what we used to call in the old-fashioned days, build character, you know, that failing will build their character. And think to yourself, that's part of being a great parent. I'm not failing or neglecting my child by doing that. I'm actually doing something great for their future.
Well, it's a remarkable article. I recommend it to everybody, The Overprotected Kid. Hanna Rosin, thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
We continue the discussion online, where we ask three experts to weigh in on how to discipline your child from toddler to teenager. Find the story on our homepage. We'd love to hear your advice as well, which you can leave in the comments section.